Now, in this example, we'll be showing you how to do a multiple regression with SPSS and then how to interpret it. So remember that we've been working with our same data set of whether mathing and the number of hours studied that each student puts forth will affect the DV, which is test scores. In this example, both the IVs, the mathing and hours of study, are predicting how much variance in the DV or test scores we're looking for. In case you forgot, mathing is a fake drug that we came up with that's supposed to increase your ability to do math. In this case, there are three levels, each student getting either 0, 10, or 20 milligrams of mathing. And the second independent variable is however many number of hours each student studied towards the test. The DV, which is test scores. Here's the data. So when you open up the SPSS icon on your computer, you want to go and click Type in Data. This will allow you the option of actually typing in the data unless you already have your data set saved in there. On the home page, you want to scroll down to the bottom left-hand corner where you see Data View and Variable View. You'll want to click on Variable View to start labeling your variables. In the variable view, in the column labeled Name, simply type in all of your DVs and IVs, like so. The Width column is set to 8. All that means is that each time you type into a box, you're allowed 8 characters. The decimals column, which is set to 2, means that all of the numbers that you type in will be up to 2 decimal places. There's no need to change this unless you feel it necessary. In the label column, this is where you can actually name your DVs and IVs. So remember, our DV is test scores. Our IV1 is mathing, or amount of mathing that each participant received, and IV2 are the number of hours that they studied. Should one of your IVs or multiple of your IVs have different levels, you can actually label them in the values column. When you click on it, say for example our mathing has 3 different levels, you type in 1 for 0 milligrams, click add, 2 for 10 milligrams, and click add, and so on until you've labeled all of your levels. Since our other IV, Hours of Study, has a single level, there's no need to label it, and we're ready to enter data in our data view. When you click on the data view, as you can see, all of our DVs and IVs are already labeled for us, so all you need to do now is type in the data the way that you saw it at the beginning of the video. For the IVs that have multiple levels, you can either actually type in the numbers. So for example, 0, 0, 0, 0, 10, 10, 10, 10, 20, 20, 20, 20 for milligrams of mathene. Or you can go to the toolbar, click on View, click on Value Label, and when you right-click, you'll see all the labels that you previously entered in the variable view. Now remember, for IV2, which is number of hours that each student studied, we don't have more than one level. We're just going to type in the numbers as they are. Now remember that the test we're using here is a multiple regression. It's multiple because we're using several variables, in this case mathing and hours of study, in order to predict a value, which would be the DV, or our test scores. In order to run a multiple regression, you want to go to Analyze, Regression, Linear, because after all, this is a linear function, even though it's multiple. Clicking on this will give you a linear regression box. All you need to do is click over your dependent variables and then your independent variables into the independent box. If you go to the right-hand side of the box and click on Options, you'll see a little box that comes up. you'll want to make sure that your alpha level is set at 0.05. Clicking on the statistics box will allow you to check the boxes for estimates, model fit, descriptives, part and partial correlations, and collinearity diagnostics. These will all be important when you're analyzing your multiple regression later. Now click OK, and you will have your voila output, a thing of beauty. And now we're going to interpret the output sheet, which of course is the fun part. So starting from the beginning at the top of the SPSS output, you'll see the model summary box. From here, if you look at the R square, it's 0.76. What that means is that 76% of the criterion variable, in this case, success on the stats test, 76% of the variance in that variable was accounted for by our model alone. The adjusted R square, 0.737, is a measure of the shrinkage we would see if we were to apply this model to a different sample. In other words, the amount of predictive loss that we would observe. In other words, again, that means that if we were to apply this model to a different sample, we would see a slight amount of loss of predictive power from 0.76 down to 0.737. So we're going to skip over the ANOVA box, which you should already know how to interpret from earlier examples, and we're going to go down to the coefficients box with the zero order, partial, part, tolerance, and VIF. Starting with the partial, this refers to the correlation between the specific independent variable and the dependent variable after all the remaining IVs have been partialed out or controlled for. So if you look at math theme, that 0.579, if you square that number, you get 0.335. meaning that 33.5% of the variance in the DV, or test scores, is accounted for by mathene after you partial out or control hours of study. So when you hold hours of study constant, then you see that mathene accounts for 33.5% of the variance. Meaning that 33.5% of the variance in the DV, or test scores, is accounted for by mathene after you partial out or control hours of study. So when you hold hours of study constant, then you see that mathene accounts for 33.5% of the variance. The part box is a measure of the semi-partial. So if you again take these values and you square them, it gives you the unique contribution of each predictor to the model. So with the example of mathene, 0.348 squared gives you approximately 12% of the variance that's accounted for by mathene uniquely. Keep note that SPSS does not square the part for us. You have to square that by hand. Similarly, if you take the part value of hours of study and you square that, 0.621 squared gives you around 38.56% of the variance that is accounted for uniquely by hours of study. Similarly, if you take the part value of hours of study and you square that, 0.621 squared gives you around 38.56% of the variance that is accounted for uniquely by hours of study. Then, if you take both of those values and you add them to each other, so the 12% variance that we saw mathene uniquely accounted for, and the roughly 38.56% of variance that hours of study accounted for, and you added them together, we would get about 50.67, meaning that these two predictors of mathene and our study uniquely account for 50.67% of the variance in the criterion variable or success on the stats test. So this 50.67 variance that we see that the two predictors uniquely account for is different from the 76% of variance that we saw with the R square in the model summary box. So 76% minus 50.67% gives us around 25.33. That represents the total overlapping predictive work done by the predictors of mathene and our study. Moving over to the right, looking at the collinearity statistics, you have tolerance and VIF. Both of these are indices of multicollinearity. Now remember, multicollinearity is a problem because it decreases the size of the multiple correlation. Our interpretation also becomes an issue because there's a high confounding due to the high intercorrelations if we found multicollinearity in our predictors. Additionally, our regression equation becomes unstable because of the high intercorrelation between our predictors. We don't really know what's going on. When you go back to your tolerance statistics, anytime your tolerance statistics are less than 0.01, it's indicative of multicollinearity. As you can see, 0.871 is greater than 0.01, so we're okay there. Additionally, the VIF, which is reciprocal of the tolerance, is another measure of multicollinearity. If these numbers are greater than 10, it also indicates multicollinearity. One last way to understand multicollinearity means that if we were to have multicollinearity here, that would mean that our predictors of mathing in our study correlate very strongly to where they are highly confounded with each other. In that way, it would be really difficult to tell which predictor is doing what, which accounts for what variance. Going up to the coefficients box with the unstandardized coefficients and standardized coefficients, this is the box that you're going to use to write out your standardized equation and your raw equation for your regression model. Looking at the B weight in the unstandardized coefficients column versus the beta weight in the standardized coefficients column, you'll see that there's a difference between the numbers. The B weights, or unstandardized, are calculated with the variables being assessed on different metrics. In this way, it's very difficult to compare our predictors to each other and to be able to determine which predictor is really the stronger of the predictors. The beta weights, however, are different because they're standardized on z-scores with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, so that you can directly compare your predictors to each other. In the same box, you'll see a significance column. Remember, usually our alpha level is at 0.05. So in here, we see that both mathing and hours of study are significant predictors of test scores. So firstly, to write our raw equation, we're going to take the B column under unstandardized coefficients. The raw equation is going to be your test score, which is our criterion variable, equals the constant 62.691 plus 5.337 mathing plus 0.827 hours of study. This will give you your raw equation. But that raw equation isn't really all that helpful to us because we want to be able to know which of our predictors predicts more, which one's stronger, and so forth. So if you go to your beta column under the standardized coefficients, you can write your standardized regression equation from there. It will follow as test score is equal to 0.373 mathing plus 0.665 hours of study. Remember that mathing, which is our first variable, is x sub 1, and hours of study, which is our second variable, is x sub 2. So when you compare the standardized regression equation to the raw regression equation, you can see the differences. With the raw regression equation, you can't really get a sense of whether mathing or hours of study is a stronger predictor. But with a standardized equation, you can see that hours of study is a much stronger predictor of test scores than mathing, because 0.665 is bigger than 0.373. So let's put this to the test. If we were to, say, get a new student in the class, and we gave that student 10 milligrams of mathine, and that student, say, studied for 20 hours for this test, we could plug those numbers in, and we would end up with a test score of around 132. The test scores don't go over 100. So unless this new student was granted some sort of special privileges or the teacher felt sorry for them and allowed them to do extra credit, a test score of 132 doesn't really make much sense. Well, okay, so let's take a look at the standardized equation. If we were to, again, put in 10 milligrams of mathine and 20 hours of study here, we would get a test score of around 17. So even with all that mathine swimming around in his body and studying all that time for that test, only a test score of 17? What's going on? So if we take a look at the data, it turns out that our data is not actually entirely linear. But that's a problem because all of the math that goes behind the linear regression, even though we've done it technically correct, is based off of the assumption that our data is linearly related, which it's not. So if we were to draw a straight line throughout this graph, which looks like it's actually curvilinear data, that raw regression line or the standardized regression line wouldn't do a very good job of predicting a curved type data. In other words, our regression equations aren't really able to capture the full relationship simply because our data is not linear. So while we found that hours of study was a better predictor of test scores than Mathene, this would explain why the test scores that we get from both of our regression equations come out so funky. So it's always a good idea to plot out your data first and look to see what it looks like before you go through all of the painful business of actually doing the math. And we hope now that multiple regression is your new best friend.